Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Taiwo Ibiemi. I am an analyst with Nextier Power. It is my honor and privilege to welcome you all to the finale of the Nextier Power Dialogue Renewable Energy Series. Prior to this event, we had two editions that convened important stakeholders from the power sector and beyond to discuss achieving sustainable power supply through renewables. The topic for discussion today is renewable energy, assessing the impact of mini and microgrids in Nigeria's electricity market. The objective of this dialogue is to discuss policy formulation as well as opportunities to enhance the Nigerian power sector, leveraging on renewable energy, and to also create opportunities for sector networking. Without further ado, I would like to invite Patrick Okibo III to introduce the speakers. Thank you.
Today, we'd like to talk with Yusuf Suleiman, the CEO of Blue Camel Energy. He'll present for about 5 minutes, and we'll spend about 10 minutes in Q&A. Yusuf. A round of applause for him.
Thank you and good evening all. Once again, my name is Suleiman Yusuf. I'm CEO of Blue Camel Energy, a company that is basically in the business of renewable energy. Blue Camel Energy was founded about 6.5 years ago when we basically started with installation of inverters and battery backup solutions for residential houses. But in the purview of the challenges with the electricity supply, we rapidly quickly discovered other challenges in the electricity industry, especially in residential homes where you put the inverter and even the grid to charge the batteries are not there, so we had to start looking out for other opportunities. Well, in these 6 years of renewable energy business, one of the most often asked questions that we have faced and one of the most challenging part of it is marketing the solution. People just don't believe that solar works in Nigeria, and that became a major challenge. So we've always had to deploy solutions on POC basis and allow people to enjoy them over time before they actually get to accept or believe that it works. That pushed us to develop a project called the Off-Grid Apartments in Abuja here, where we have 10 apartments that are totally off the grid. We ensured that we don't have a generator set at the scene, nor do we have any grid connection, just to prove that this solution, that we can actually live totally on renewable energy resources. The project is actually a 60 kilowatt solution, where we have 6 kilowatt per apartment. Assuming 6 hours of sunlight or wind speed, then we have about 36 kilowatt hour of power per apartment. And I think every average household in Nigeria can live on that energy. It's a combination of wind and solar resources to generate power, and we also have solar water heating systems on the building to ensure that we don't exhaust the battery power saved on heating water. We also have a solar water supply system, you know, with a 57,000 liter overhead tank, you know, pumped by solar as well on the building. And we have a couple of, I think the entire perimeter lighting solutions are independently powered, you know, solar powered. So that also reduces the need for power or the drawback from energy draw from the battery. You know, so basically, that has answered the question of the workability of these solar solutions. And since we established that project, we've seen a lot of people come to see before they believe, and then they've also gone ahead to install this kind of solar solutions also. Basically, the bulk of it will be more of questions from your side on how, you know, maybe different questions must have run across your mind on how we've lived in this building for the past 16 months, without a blink, and we've not lost any bulb because the power is so clean and stable. We've not had any second of light out, and we're still going. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Suleiman. I heard of this project, and I had to go see it myself, and it is pretty remarkable. I came out of the visit and I couldn't contain myself, and I was all over Facebook promoting it as if I owned a share in the company. And what we've done is we got him to shoot a video, which is showing at the back of the room, and I really encourage everyone to see the video. But again, it raised a number of questions in my mind. We saw the solar panels on the roof, we saw the battery bank, we saw the inverters, and I wonder what's the lifespan of these panels? You know, how long would these things last before anyone in the room who chooses to go that route has to replace them?
Okay, thank you. Basically, solar panels have 25 years lifespan, but that is standard solar panels with known sources and certification and all that properly tested. In any case, we have three classes of solar panels now in the market. The grade A panels, which are those that we know their origin and we know all the certifications that they have. Quite a couple of names to tie to that. Then we have the grade B panels, which are not exactly on that first line, but they work very well, and you cannot really guarantee 25 years lifespan because most of those companies haven't even existed for that long to have tested their product. And we have the grade C solar panels that are mostly unbranded, without definite, source. But in any case, they all work. It just depends on your budget. And if you're an investor who, or if you have need for energy and you cannot afford a solution that will last 25 years, perhaps you're not looking that long. So the grade B panels, they actually could work. But averagely, 25 years is the lifespan of the solar panel, while battery lifespan ranges from 3 to 12 years, depending on the type of battery and depending on how much you invest on the battery from the beginning. Depending also on the use, the cycling of the battery, the operating condition or temperatures where you have it installed. And, so there are quite a number of factors that affect the battery lifespan, but averagely from 3 to 12 years, you can keep enjoying your batteries.
Okay, so let's think of a typical three-bedroom bungalow, yeah? And let's assume that each of the rooms has an AC, 2 horsepower, you've got a fridge, a freezer, maybe 2 or 3 televisions, light points, etc. How much power does this type of home need, and how much would a solar solution for this home cost?
Well, let me use the greenhouse as a case study. We have the minimum number of ACs in any particular apartment is 4. On a solar solution, your usage behavior, of course, have to change. Because you have 4 ACs that can run, doesn't mean that you just put them on and run them simultaneously. But that's when you have to check and find out if you really need the AC to run. In any case, the solution, the 6 kilowatt solution we have there with a 4 kilowatt inverter system runs on 8 numbers of 200 Ah batteries. That's about 400 ampere battery bank. That can run 2 numbers of AC. I'm emphasizing on the air conditioning because that usually is where the challenge is with solar deployments, because just 1 AC could consume even more power than the entire house itself. So running 1 AC, you can run 1 AC for 24 hours on that solution. So if you're running the 2 ACs, then you can go for like 12 hours for the 2 ACs. So it depends on what kind of mix you're looking at. But this is on a typical sunny day. So the cost of that kind of package, I'll use the figures as at sometimes last year when the exchange rate was still 165. The cost of the entire solution for the 10 apartments was 25 million naira. So breaking down that into 10 units, that's about 2.5 million naira per apartment. But we didn't just stop there. We went ahead to do a business scenario, a business case study, and we factored in cost of battery replacement over another 10 years. That brought the cost to about 35 million naira for the entire deployment and 10 years maintenance and battery replacement cost. Now, if you break that down to a daily energy cost, you end up with about 970 naira per day. That's your cost of...
For the entire building?
Yes, for the entire building. No, for each apartment.
For each apartment.
Yes, 970 naira per day. Now, that's your cost of clean, uninterrupted power supply. Perhaps if you're on the grid and you have stable electricity, your PHCN bill definitely will exceed that amount. But if you're in a situation where you probably go 6 hours on the grid and 6 hours on gen, or 18 hours on the grid and 6 hours, it depends on the mix. But whichever way it is, the best case scenario is that you have to run your gen for 6 hours. And if you do that, your energy costs per day will probably shoot up to about 3,000 plus. So I think that clearly shows the cost efficiency of the solar solution. Over a 24-year plan, the cost even goes down cheaper.
But what happens on a rainy day? You know, what happens when there is thick cloud cover and you're now fully off-grid, you don't have a generator in the house? What happens?
Interestingly, that's why we have the wind turbines on the building. The wind turbines are much more effective when the sun is not there, you know. Mostly during rainstorms or at night, you know, we still generate about 1.5 kilowatt from the wind turbine, so that keeps the building going. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Yusuf. Maybe some questions, one or two? Yeah? Simon?
I've got three questions, but they're really one question. Okay. And that's from the purely engineering point of view. I'd like to know, for that, you know, prototype building, the average amp hours generated by the house per module for each house. What would be the average amp hour per day? And then secondly, what's the total amperage draw at peak load for the house, like with all the appliances you have? Or ACs, assuming you decide to run them on full blast. So let's say at peak energy, peak load, what will be the total amperage draw? Then finally, well, you just answered that question earlier on, like the capacity of storage, but then redundancy for how many days? You know, do you have energy storage for 24 hours without any recharge? Or is it like redundancy for 2 days, 3 days, 5 hours? And that's just what I want to know.
Thank you.
Okay.
My name is Chima from Schematic Blue Energy. I just want to ask, when you were doing your financial analysis, you talked about the cost of the solar panels and all the accessories. Then the moderator now asked about the rainy days when the sun is not out. Then you now brought in about the wind turbines. Now, the cost of the wind turbine, was it included when you were talking about the financial analysis?
Thank you.
My question is about the economics of the cost to give us. And if you look, 25 to 30 million for an average Nigerian might be quite a huge sum. And I don't know what income group you're targeting in such solutions. If you're targeting a certain level of income, people who can afford to pay 30 million is not low income.
Thank you very much.
Let me take the question from Kappa Solera. You've asked about the autonomy, the AH, and the peak load. The capacity of inverter installed there is a 6 kilowatt inverter with a 100% surge capability. And 0.9 power factor. That means it can run comfortably at 90% of that 6,000 watts. So at 5,400 watts, the system still runs very well. That's for the peak load. In any case, the peak load in the building, when you put on the four air conditioners running, we're using the energy efficient ACs, which runs at 600 watts for the 1 horsepower and 900 watts for the 1.5 horsepower. So if you put together the energy consumption of the four ACs put together, it takes you at just about less than, you know, 3,000 or about 3,000 watts. So you still have another 50% capacity to run your microwave, electric iron. We also run the internal water heaters. Despite the overhead water heaters, we still have internal water heaters. So at emergency situations or situations of poor sunlight, we could actually kick in those water heaters, and the inverter capacity is good enough to handle it. That's for the peak load. In terms of the autonomy, we have done our design for a 72-hour autonomy. You know, given the sun hours in the Abuja location here, which is about 5.4 sun hours per day, and the support from the wind turbine, which, you know, irrespective of the rainy weather, continues to put something into the battery. Now, there is another third question about the AH of the module. I usually do my calculations in the of power generation in watts, and then if we need to convert that to AH, I'll probably get engaged with the calculator now. But the solar panels are of 200 watts monocrystalline, 24 volts, 5.7 amps per module. So by the time we have about 30 units of that module for every two apartments, then that's about 15 units for one apartment at 5.6 amp hour per module. Then the question from Chima, he asked about the cost of the wind, if it is inclusive. Yes, the wind turbine is inclusive in that cost analysis that I just shared with you. And that's part of why the costing got as much as that 30 million naira. The other question here, 25 to 30 million naira, yes, it sounds quite that's some chunk, but this is to be divided by 10 families. And when you consider what we spend on powering our diesel generators daily to ensure uninterrupted power, it takes you less than 3 years or 2 years to break even this cost. In most cases, I've seen so many households where the cost of tiling alone, the amount of money put into tiling, is more than 2.5 million naira. So why not energy? And this is a renewable source which continues to replenish itself day in, day out. A lot of times I wake up in the morning and I just get to my balcony, and once I see the sun, I just smile to myself. You know, you know. So I don't think the cost, if you do the economics very well, over a 24 years period, your cost of power generation drops to 13 naira per kilowatt hour. I just use the naira and kobo, you know, just for easier understanding. But we've worked out the cost analysis here, and we've compared the cost of running on solar to running on 100% generator, 75%, 50%, and 25%. And we've also assumed that a time will come when your grid electricity is consistent and uninterrupted. We've also considered that cost at 24 naira per kilowatt hour. It will not remain there. And I want to also believe that some sort of subsidies are still involved in that kind of PHCN costing. So when you compare that to the solar power generation, which drops to 13 naira per kilowatt over a 24-year period, I think, you know, if you look at the long run, it's definitely the option to go with.
Ladies and gentlemen, please, a round of applause for Suleiman Yusuf. Thank you very much. He will be around at the end of the program to take more questions. And I also encourage you to find time to view the video because it's quite impressive. So moving on real quick, permit me to invite the panelists for today's discussion. I have Dr. Sanusi Oheri, who is a renewables expert with GIZ. Mr. Ifeanyi Orajaka, who is the CEO of GVE Projects. And Engineer Farouk Yabo, who's an assistant director in the Federal Ministry of Power. Thank you. Each of them will take about 5 to 7 minutes to make an opening remark on the topics they've been assigned, and then we'll spend about 20, 25 minutes in a moderated session and then open it up for audience participation. I'll start with
Sanusi.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's always a pleasure to come and talk about rural electrification and solutions for off-grid. Today, I have between 5 to 7 minutes to give a general overview of how mini-grids and micro-grids could be used to solve some of the power challenges that we have, you know, in the country. Just to, as a way of, you know, just contextualizing the scale of the problem, I mean, we're all stakeholders here, we all want power, but as good as that is, it's sad enough to know that 1.3 billion people still do not have access to electricity worldwide, and 85% of these people reside in the rural areas of sub-Saharan Africa and Asia, and sub-Saharan Africa only has an electrification rate of 32%. Coming down, bringing down home to Nigeria, the seventh largest, most populous nation in the world, we have just between 35 to 55% of people that do not have access to electricity at all. And that translates to between 83 and 100 million people. So we estimate that our population is between 180 to 183 million now. And just imagine us having between 83 to 100 million people not having access. So, but from various sources, it's estimated to be between 35 to 55. And that's also a problem because we don't actually have, you know, the data on that. So that's just, you know, that as a way of contextualizing the scale of the problem. So mini-grids and micro-grids, what are mini-grids, what are micro-grids? Is there any difference? You know, are they the same? Basically, there is no universally agreed definition for mini or micro-grids. What we could just, you know, say is distinguishing them in terms of, you know, the sizes, you know, categorizing them based on sizes and all of that. And various literature have, you know, propounded various sizes for the microgrid, the mini grid, the pico solar home systems, and all of that. And most of them typically categorize microgrids to be between 5 kilowatts to 50 kilowatts, and the mini grids between 50 kilowatts to less than 1 megawatt. Some people even say micro and mini, they just lump them up into one and say they are between 10 kilowatts to 10 megawatts. So that shouldn't really be any source of concern for us right now for the purpose of this presentation. What we need to understand is, you know, that any set of electricity generators or battery storage system, like Yusuf, you know, just explained to us now, that you're able to interconnect with a distribution network. They just go for mini or micro grids, whether they are, you know, 5 kilowatts or 10 kilowatts or 1 megawatt. But based on the draft mini-grid regulations that is currently before NERC, and they are looking at between 100 to 1 megawatt, 100 kilowatts to 1 megawatt, or between 0 to 1 megawatt for generation and distribution. So that's what the mini-grid regulation is based on. So for Nigeria, we could say that the mini-grids or micro-grids, you know, can be between 0 to 1 megawatt for generation and distribution. So we have various technology options that we can use for mini grids. We have the solar PV systems, just like you've mentioned now, Yusuf, and it works perfectly well. We have the small hydropower system, the SHS. We have wind turbines, bioenergy technologies, gas or diesel generators, battery storage, fuel cells, even combined cycle gas turbines. So why are mini grids important, you know, for as an option for electricity supply? First of all, we want the end objective is to have electricity. We want electricity. We want it, you know, to be secure, uninterrupted, and sustainable. Mini-grids can act as this sort of reliable and sustainable service to consumers, especially hybrid systems where you have solar PVs, diesel backup, solar and SHS systems and all of that. So it also helps to decongest the grid. For instance, in Nigeria, we have a situation where we have, you know, generation going into the grid, and we have so many underserved areas. So with mini grids coming into isolated areas where you don't necessarily need to, you know, extend the grid to. You free up more power, you know, for the grid, you know, to distribute to other areas. So it also has some environmental benefits. It helps to reduce greenhouse effects, and it ensures energy security because you're able to diversify your energy mix. And that's currently what the government is trying to achieve, and I'm sure Farouk will talk more about that. And the fact that we have the declining, you know, cost of solar right now, except of course with this exchange rate that is just messing up everything, it's also an, you know, opportunity, because this cost is actually coming down. Some challenges real quick: we have the lack of data, because for you to be able to plan efficiently for mini grids deployment, especially at the national scale, you need to know where, you know, the grid is, where it stops, and then what's the distance between the closest grid and you know, the next rural community, and how many people in that village. You do your viability analysis, demand assessments, and all of that. So most of this data we don't have, so it's a problem. We also have government policy and regulations. Like I said, we still have draft mini grid regulations. We are hoping that by next week, the stakeholders' consultative round will go on, and hopefully when the commissioners come in, you know, it will be signed and approved. And we have, for government policy, Yusuf will talk more about that. And utility financing, lack of maintenance and capacity and all of that, these are some of the challenges. And for operator models for mini grids, we have community-based models, private sector, public-private sector, development partnerships with private sector as well, utility-based models, and a hybrid, a mixture of some of these. Just to give a summary of some of the data on mini grids, worldwide, we have about 26 million people currently using, 26 million households, that's about 100 million people currently served through mini grids, and 20 million households currently served through SHS worldwide. That's according to the International Renewable Energy Agency. And China leads in this development. They have almost 50,000 decentralized systems, although most of them are connected, you know, to the grid. But then they still have over 10,000 that are off-grid. And they get the energy source through small hydropower and solar. So we have Bangladesh, Morocco, India, and Mali among some of the countries that have more than 10,000 mini-grids, you know, decentralized, not connected to, you know, to the grid. But Nigeria only has, I mean, we have less than 50 mini-grids, both successful and failed. So that's just to tell you how far we need to go. We did some analysis at the NESP where we tried, it's cluster analysis. We tried to look at where the grid is and then communities that currently do not have access to the grid. We came up with 46,000 clusters approximately for the whole country. And out of this, we have about 83 million people out of 181 million people that do not have access to electricity. And what we did was to take a buffer, a 10-kilometer buffer, 20-kilometer buffer around the grid to say, okay, all the communities within this buffer would naturally go for grid, and then the rest would go for either mini grids and solar home systems. And for the 10-kilometer buffer, we saw opportunity for 7,882 clusters. That's about 26 million people that are good to go with, you know, I mean, where we have opportunities for mini grids. And then solar home systems, we had about 5.5 million people. And for the 20-kilometer buffer, we had about 3,800 clusters for mini grids. That's about 12.8 million people. And the solar home systems, we had 7,210 clusters. That's about 2.8 million people. So very, very quickly, just to, you know, conclude, we have a long way to go in terms of mini grids development in Nigeria. Planning is very important. We need to get data. We need to make sure we accelerate the draft mini grid regulations. The rural education plan, strategy and plan has just been approved. We also need to implement it to the letter. The rural education fund needs to be operationalized. Stakeholder coordination, this should be driven by the Ministry of Power or the Rural Electrification Agency, is very important. And then we also need to pay attention to rural electrification off-grid solutions. I mean, we've spent all this money on the grid side of things. It's a good thing. The focus is there. We'll also try mini-grids so that we'll see how far that can go, you know, for us. So I'd like to stop here quickly. I would take any questions
afterwards.
Afterwards. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Ifeanyi Orajaka runs GVE. They've executed about 6 mini-grid projects in Rivers, Anambra, Niger, Gombe. They raised about $2.2 million, and they've been rated by USAID and a number of other international organizations. We're interested in learning from you, because I'm sure there are people in the audience, you know, who are looking at the same space, some of the financing strategies for developing mini and micro grids. Ifeanyi.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. As introduced, my name is Ifeanyi Orajaka. I lead GVE Projects Limited Nigeria. GVE, we are renewable energy solutions providers. We provide solutions for residential, commercial, and most important to us, rural off-grid communities, using a combination of mini-grids and standalone solar home systems. I must confess, the earlier speakers have actually made my work a lot easier. So I'll just go in and maybe tell the story of how we actually started the company, where we are now, and some of the challenges and some of the prospects we have, and envision for the near future. Basically, about 9 years ago, some three young undergraduate students of Federal University of Technology, Uri, they were interning in one of the leading oil and gas multinational companies operating in the Delta. And during the course of the internship, we were privileged to embark on several field facility inspection visits in some of the sites scattered across the Delta. And during the course of these visits, we observed the very disturbing and appalling trend. What we have in most of the facilities, we have excess power, 24-hour supply of electricity. But in communities 500 meters, 1 kilometer, 2 kilometers away from this settlement, they were in abject energy poverty. And at that point, we were like, okay, this is not actually what we came here for. We came here to intern. And basically, like every young engineer in Nigeria, or young engineering student in Nigeria, build a career in the oil and gas industry. But with the trend or the frequency of recurrence, it got us to shift our career thoughts and also our personal instincts. But we decided to see how we can use our engineering and social skills to provide solution to these communities. And in line with that, we're privileged to have several collaboration. The first being the IEEE, Institute of Electrical Electronics Engineers, while still undergraduate students. We worked with them to, I would say, pioneer the mini-grid technology in not only Nigeria, but also in West Africa. So we started up the product and the project development back in 2009. Well, actually, we implemented our first project back in 2013. We worked with IEEE, provided some funding, and also the graciously UNDP and Bank of Industry Assessed Renewable Project Office in 2012. And with those two financing, we were able to implement a 6 kilowatt system in a community called Ibike Community in Eche local government area of Rivers State. The project was completed in September 2013. And since then till now, through the system, we were able to supply about an average of 60 households within 14 to 16 hours of electricity a day. But going forward after that, because of the successes of the project, graciously we got the support of the U.S. government Power Africa Initiative with a grant funding of $100,000 USD, which we were able to match from revenue additional $20,000 to implement two additional systems of 9 kilowatt capacities each. And going from the success trend, when the BOI and UNDP Access to Renewable Energy Office, we actually in the stage of actually implementing projects. But because of the pedigree and because of the hands-on experience we had in the sector, we got into collaboration, more deeper collaboration with them this time. Permit me at this point to say that the first three projects we embarked, we appealed the grant funding, just to shed more light on the topic I was actually asked to talk on, because at that point it was very risky to commit commercial capital, because it was a novel and untested market, not only in Nigeria but also in West Africa. So along the course of the line, we were able to raise a little of equity and more of debt financing, concessional debt, I would say, single digit long term from Bank of Industry to expand our capacity and implement three additional projects in one in Niger, one in Gombe, and the third one in Anambra. By the way, the one in Niger is in about 8 days time. The community will be celebrating 365 days of zero power cut, uninterrupted power supply. And personally, with the experience and working in the sector, it's been very phenomenal and at the same time amazing. Because you see, personal experience, seeing communities transforming. You see, children are better able to study at night. You see, their grades are improving, and you see a lot of other development impact. Particularly, the Pisanti project. The project is more or less, at the moment, Pisanti is the one in Niger State, is more or less a regional hub for the local government because of the uninterrupted power nature of their electricity supply. Our people coming all the way from Bida and all the other neighboring communities to come and do business in the community. And moving forward on that, at the moment, we have a pipeline of about 16 projects, and we are seriously working with GIZ to implement several other projects across the country. So I can say, even for us as developers and even for financiers and investors, the mini grid sector is still very novel, I would say, although technology has actually been able to transition from the developing to getting to the market ready status at the moment. So for the investors, they are still trying to figure out what model of financing that works. But for us as a company, we've tried out several financing options. We've tried out the straight grant. We've tried out debt finance. And very soon, like I said, we've been able, over the years, we've raised about 2.2 million, and we're working on a financing round that we'll see to raising about 3.7 million USD in the next couple of months. Thank you.
Thank you very much. If I'm sure we have lots of questions. When we get to that, we'll explore those issues. But we've seen from Sanusi's presentation that mini grids work. We've seen Ifeanyi's project, it's transformed communities. I'm sure the question on everyone's mind is, what's the government doing to promote more investments in the space? So permit me to invite Engineer Farouk Yabo to tell us the policies to promote investments in mini and micro grids. He is a resident expert on renewables in the Ministry of Power, so do not hesitate to ask questions.
Thank you very much, Patrick, for getting me on the hot seat. Now, the topic that you've chosen is quite an apt topic, understanding and accessing the use of mini grids in Nigerian electricity sector. Now, what I plan to do is first to talk about some global best practice in terms of policies, and then what the government of Nigeria is doing to move the process forward. The good thing is Mr. Sanusi has actually underscored the very essence of why we should use mini grids. Currently, about 47,000 clusters have been defined in the country. And out of this, over 45,000 are unelectrified. So that gives you a picture of what the magnitude of need is. Of course, it doesn't mean 90% of Nigerians doesn't have light. But because the population has moved on to those areas that have grids, you have about 80% or 80 million people living today without electricity in Nigeria. So this is a big issue for the government and calls for us to take action. Now, I'll go straight to some of the best practice policies that have been adopted globally to deal with the issue and to promote mini-grids. First of all is the issue of targets. Governments all over the world that needs to move forward in terms of these issues need to set up targets so that people can see. Businessmen used to see the long-term vision of government. Apart from that, the issue of duty waivers and taxes, that's economic policies of government with respect to mini-grids, have been implemented across the world. Again, the issue of streamlining licensing and permitting procedures has also been a major issue that has been used to promote mini-grids across the country. Of course, that includes a process for concessioning and PPAs. The next other issue that has been used is the issue of financial support, mainly through long-term concessionary financing and subsidies, including OPEX and CAPEX. Again, financial risk instruments have been deployed in different jurisdictions to ensure these things are also working. And then finally, issue of technical assistance, which has to do with the issues raised by Yusuf, mostly to do with awareness creation, market development, capacity building. All these have been established as basic must-do policies for this kind of systems to operate. Now, what is the federal government of Nigeria doing to accomplish or to meet all these challenges? In the last 2 years, there has been a number of issues and a number of things that have happened, starting from institutional reforms and policy development. The Ministry of Power, the Ministry of Water Resources, and Ministry of Environment have all been restructured somehow to ensure that there is a robust structure to actually drive the process. In the case of the Ministry of Power, where I work, back in 2014, end of 2014, the Renewable Energy and Rural Power Access Department, where I work as an assistant director, was established. And the essence of that department is to promote policies and programs and measures that could see the advancement of energy access, particularly in the rural areas, and promotion of renewable energy. And of course, energy efficiency. Now, since the creation of that department, a number of policy documents have so far been developed, some of them for the first time, and they have been approved. I can mention some of them. The National Renewable Energy and Energy Efficiency Policy, which was approved in May, that policy clearly defines the targets for this government in terms of what we are going to be achieving up to 2030. Following up to that, the policy requires that national action plans should be established. These action plans are to set up trajectories of development on year-by-year basis from now up to 2030. That has also been done, and it has been approved and validated last July. All these documents will be made available to you as we speak. Again, just last 2 weeks, the federal government have approved, for the first time since the reform, the National Rural Electrification Strategy and Plan. This is one of the most critical documents that is going to allow the opening up of the sector, because it automatically operationalizes the Rural Electrification Fund. The Rural Electrification Fund is the subsidy facility that the federal government has provided through the REA, Rural Electrification Agency, to support in terms of technical assistance and in terms of capital subsidy projects. So already there is a transition from the old way of doing things where government implement projects to government now running programs. Away from government funding 100% projects to government leveraging on private sector and other sources of funding for each naira spent. Also, away from doing rural education for purposes of electrifying to going into rural education for purposes of rural development, which includes water provision, telecommunication, and education and health. All this have been properly captured in this policy document that have just been approved after several years of efforts to deliver. On top of all of this, also in the same July, the Nigeria Sea for All Action Agenda, that's the Sustainable Energy for All Action Agenda for the country, which Sanusi did mention about, was also approved through a concessionary coordinated work of Ministry of Environment, Ministry of Water Resources, and all other ministries working together. And so for the first time, we are seeing coordination coming out to play in all of this. With all this, one will expect that in the next couple of months, probably, the issue of mini-grids, for instance, should be something that will be given a lot of attention, because with the draft mini-grid regulation, which is being discussed currently in NAC, as mentioned also by Sanusi, those developers that are willing and ready to invest will have the best opportunity in terms of a clear, transparent, predictable, and of course contractually binding agreement to be able to move forward with access using mini-grids. Some of the other issues that I would like to mention for sake of us is the fact that there is already a target of 70% access by 2020 and 90% access by 2030, and a target of 8,000 megawatt upgrade capacity by 2030. Also, like I mentioned earlier, a number of developing partners are working to provide concessionary loan. I can here mention what AFD is doing in terms of structuring concessionary long-term loans. Also, African Development Bank is working with us to come out with some financing structures. In terms of development support, GIZ has done quite a lot. They are doing quite a lot still. USAID is also doing a number of things. And so I think the stage is set. We are moving from power points to power plants, clearly. And therefore, I want to assure everyone here that the government is doing a lot. And within the shortest possible time, we shall see the ball now is going to be thrown back to the private sector. And hopefully, we shall see action from your side. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Yusuf. We're excited that we're finally moving from PowerPoints to power plants. Let me start by asking you, Sanusi. I know that through GIZ, you've been doing a lot of work with, you know, the government of Nigeria and a number of other key stakeholders. We agree that mini grids should be an effective alternative to this big, massive grid we have across Nigeria. What are you saying to government that, you know, government needs to do to unlock this sector? How do we move beyond these very mini 8,000 megawatt, 10,000 megawatt targets that we're chasing to completely disrupt the sector and chase the types of target that India announced just last week, that they're chasing 175 gigawatts of power by 2022? What are you saying to government, and how do we completely move beyond these single-digit targets that we've set for ourselves?
Okay, thank you very much, Patrick. Well, I can't say all that I want to say to government, because I work with, you know, GIZ, and then we are partners with the government. But I think we've been talking a lot, and they are beginning to listen. I think the focus was more on in the grid side of things before, and we've been trying to get the attention of the government to try the option for mini grids and off grid, and that's why we in our program we have a very structured framework, from on grid renewables to, you know, trying to help the government with data management, gathering data for renewable energy, rural electrification, getting clusters where, you know, we've not, you know, connected electricity to, and then planning for rural electrification. So we've been working closely with them. and they're beginning to listen, you know, to be honest. Like Farouk said, they've come up with different policies, and recently the rural electrification implementation strategy plan we've been following that up since 2012 or 2013, and so that's a right step in the right direction. So, but away from beginning to do things, they need to really implement, you know, some of these policies. The draft mini-grid regulation, maybe the next guys are there, they can mention a few things about it, because we're going to start, you know, the stakeholder consultative forums where everybody will have an input into the mini-grid regulations. I think we're going to Lagos and Enugu next week, and Upper Week will be in Kaduna, and then we'll come back to Abuja. So maybe you can give them an opportunity to talk about it. People can also pitch in, you know, the ideas on how to improve it. So I think we are moving in the right direction.
What confidence do you have that we as a country have the ability to implement these policies? And if we don't, what are some of the things we need to do to improve our ability to implement?
Well, going by, you know, previous governments and previous experiences, I don't really have much confidence. But with what this government, change government, has demonstrated, we're beginning to see that.
Not the mantra now. Yeah. Like in real practical.
No, yeah. To be honest, I mean, they are beginning to really listen. And then the attention, when you speak to them initially, you could sense them foot dragging. But right now, they know that it's important. They have to just look that way. So, yeah, that's why we are supporting them, you know, to be able to achieve some of these things and implement them, you know, efficiently. And they are not chasing us away, and they are not saying that they do not want our support. So that's to show that, you know, they are really ready for, you know, the mini-grid sector.
Ifeanyi, you had mentioned that you're in the process of doing a private placement, if I heard you correctly. Can you share with us some of the challenges you've had with raising money, and if you met the President Buhari today, or if he said to you, go solve this problem, what are the three things you do to unlock financing for projects such as yours, from your experience as a practitioner?
Thanks so much, Patrick. Speaking from a private sector perspective and having been in the sector for close to a decade now, I would say over the past few years, like Yusuf rightly said, there's been a very serious paradigm shift. And actually, government is beginning to be more responsive and a lot more proactive. And the most important one being the draft regulation, because as a private sector, raising private financing from investors and also debt financiers, one of the major barriers is the issue of no regulation. And for us, so having raised close to 2.5 million USD without regulation, I believe with when the regulation is in place, we'll actually multiply that by tenfold, because it gives a lot more confidence to our backers. And secondly, the issue of incentive. On that as well, I would say the government has tried, because GVE, we are beneficiaries of the NIPC Pioneer Status Incentive. But and also we, for solar panels, we're able to get duty waiver, but I believe the government can do a lot more than that. We've been negotiating or discussing with the government at several levels. As a body, including in collaboration with the Nigerian Economic Summit Group, and we've made a lot of contributions to how we see government playing more facilitatory roles to help improve the sector. So one is deregulation, secondly the issue of incentive, particularly the tax waivers or duty and duty waivers for renewable energy projects. And also is the issue of standards, because it's beginning to, in the near future, it's with the whole interest in the sector, if more stringent standards are not put in place, it's going to actually get the sector very messy. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll open it up for audience participation in another second, but I wanted to ask you, Yusuf, it appears to me that there's so many moving parts here. And I don't see the person who's responsible for sequencing everything that needs to happen. You know, who's going to make sure that there are standards? You know, who's going to make sure that the goods coming in through the ports
are cleared on time and you don't pay the waivers and etc. Is it the Ministry of Power? If it's not the Ministry of Power, should we have something like a presidential tax force on renewable energy that's focused on it? What are the thoughts within the ministry on this?
Thank you again, Patrick. I think these issues are very clear. When you look at the policy, the National Renewable Energy Policy, it makes it very clear. The Minister of Finance is required to work with the customs to establish a special tax force within the customs that will be responsible for a setting up. This is in the process of being set up. And that's why currently people that are importing some of this equipment comes to the Ministry of Power and we write to Ministry of Finance pending on when these issues are sorted out. So clearly the mandate is for the customs, but it is, according to the policy, the responsibility of the Minister of Finance to establish that particular tax force or special customs unit, if you like.
Yeah, but you see, that's one thing that needs to happen, and it's stuck now with the Ministry of Finance. There are 15 other things that need to happen that are also stuck at different places. My uninformed view is that maybe we need someone responsible for ensuring that the Ministry of Finance or the Minister of Finance does what she's supposed to do, and that the customs person does their own, and Standards Organization of Nigeria, Bank of Industry, etc. Shouldn't that be something that the Ministry of Power should be pushing for, or else we'll keep pointing fingers and laying blames?
Absolutely, Patrick. In fact, in the Sustainable Energy Board Action Agenda, there is a particular chapter that is called coordination. And there is supposed to be a focal point institution. Currently, I serve as the focal point person for CPOL in the country. No, absolutely not. Not the person that is coordinating ministers. Obviously, a minister cannot be coordinated beyond lower than anybody like a minister. So what the point is there will be reporting. There will be annual reporting on the activities of every party so that the president himself will see each ministry, each line ministry, what has they done based on the target set for each person. Because like I've said earlier, the target set are actually for different MDAs, and each of these MDAs are responsible for even contribution to our national emission reduction contributions. So it will be an interesting thing for the Minister of Finance, Minister of Environment, to report to the President what is happening. So in essence, at this point, I think it's only reporting that we have. We do not have any one single person that is going to be talking to Minister of Finance, Minister of Power. I don't think that structure is there as we speak.
Okay. I'm not totally convinced, but I'll open it up for others to contribute.
Before I go on, I think the coordination for the SE for All, my name is Dr. Afolabi Otitoju, sorry I didn't mention. I'm a renewable energy consultant. And the coordination talked about in the SE for All Action Agenda is actually, if implemented, is actually going to go a long way to help provide this coordination talked about. Because at the end of the day, ministers will come and go. Presidents will come and go. But we need the core public servants to drive this. These ones won't go. Even if they will go, it will take up to 20, 30 years. So the coordination, the SC for All coordination, which Farouk talks about, is mainly going to be driven by the public sector. That's one. Thank you very much. Number two, I have... a question for, I'll just leave it to Ifeanyi. Good presentation, but I want to ask, most people would say solar is not viable, is expensive, is this, is that, and how would rural areas pay? I wanted to share experience with us about the ability to pay. You're focused on rural areas, the ability to pay. Number two, what are your frameworks for collection of your money? I'm sure it's not free, you know, how do you go about? And then are you thinking about, just very recently, we just did a study on RE and EE to SMEs and corporate organizations. Are you looking to expand to SMEs and corporate organizations. That's what you find. Sanusi, just one more for Sanusi. You talked about planning. In all of these, green mini-grid framework, all of these, we, from my own experience, we seem not to have a planning framework. What do I mean by planning framework? The one that will tell you how to structure your mini-grid system, what process you need to go through in rural areas. And so I know NEC is doing one of them, but beyond that, as an expert, you will know there is, in other countries, developed countries, there's need for planning. What is GIZ doing or development partners doing to put this in place and also to in line to support the green mini-grid framework and other things you're planning? Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I'd just like to get very practical. I'd like to find out, I want to get a sense of a timeline of when this is all going to happen, because that was kind of part of how this event was advertised. You know, forgive me to be bring it down to ground level. You know, there was no presidential task force on pure water. There was none. But it took off in this country in a big way. There was no presidential task force on Nollywood. But it took off. Because people saw something, they believed in it, and it happened. And for me, one of the indices you can measure the success of something in this country is the IGI. Okay? The IGI is the Igbo Guys Index. When Igbo guys jump into something, that thing is happening. You don't need a presidential task force.
He's Igbo.
No, it doesn't matter. No, that's not the point. This one has been to school. This is not an Igbo guy. We know what I'm talking about. So, on a serious note, when is the IGI going to kick in? Then we'll know this thing is real. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Tokumo Miale. I run a renewable energy and financing consulting firm called UNITCOM. Two questions. One directed to Farouk. And I always find issues in terms of policy. And when we try to, in Nigeria, we try to reinvent policies. A typical thing is the definition of macro and mini grid. When what I had that's passing through the document passing through the ministry says it's going to be between 0 and 1 megawatt, whereas in other countries it's up to 10. Why? We always seem to now, and it's got to do in line with when somebody mentioned India going about 175 gig. When you start belittling the standards, it means you don't have vision to actually fall in line with other people. And the second question is, I don't think he will be able to answer. It's a financial question. And that is, assuming we even go on the 1 meg, there is no thought of PPA. Because we have PPA for, who is going to finance? Because definitely you wouldn't expect the World Bank or GIZ. This is just a one-off instance. If there is no GIZ or all these NGOs, that means anybody who wants to do anything will not go nowhere. Because for instance, let's say 1 gig is going to cost you $2 million. You can raise 10%. Who is going to fund the remaining 1.8? Nobody. And if you want to get from abroad, you have to have a PPA.
Yeah, my question is for Yusuf.
Luke Kamel?
No, the Yusuf. One on the panel. Okay. Yes, sir. You mentioned, okay, my name is I'm a real estate developer. You mentioned something about if developers come in now into register their interest to connect to a mini grid or so. So I don't know if you meant real estate developers. I heard you when you were saying that during your presentation.
My name is Oluwaseyi Amada. I've seen there has been a lot of emphasis on policy, but the Nigeria Electricity Regulatory Commission just came out with a guideline or a draft guideline that is going for public consultation on the way these things are going to be done, the mini-grid regulation guidelines. And it talks, it's very comprehensive from the beginning to the end on what people need to do. So I will implore people to like read the guidelines, I mean the draft, and try to attend the public consultations so that they can contribute in making the guidelines better. But I also want to add about policy. From experience in Nigeria,
Anytime we try to make the federal government to do most of these things, it ends up being stuck. So I think it's time to start liberalizing the market and let private people, determine the course of the way the mini grid is going to go.
Excellent. Okay.
Yeah, that's it.
Thank you very much.
Salam, from the NERC. A follow-up to what Dr. Shehu has just said now, to let you know that the mini grid regulation, which is coming up for consultation soon, one in Lagos, in Enugu and Kaduna, in Lagos on Monday next week, in Enugu on Wednesday next week, and in Kaduna the following week on 4th of October. So these are already scheduled program for this to kickstart. Actually, the summary of it is that as we have today, we have 11 distribution companies. Each of them sees the whole of the land of their area as their own franchise. So when you want to go and put power there, they see you actually taking their own business franchise. The regulation will help you to give you opportunity to go to where they currently don't exist, where they don't find now not currently being served, to actually do your business of supplying power as a mini grid operator there and develop the place as based on the regulation. So it's a way to, like you said, liberalize the area, leave this issue of holding down development, holding down a franchise and not developing it,
sure,
and not and then leaving it. That's what it's going to be. So I invite you all to these programs. In Lagos, it will be at the Lagos Airport Hotel on Monday from 10 o'clock. And in Enugu, it will be at Nickel Lake Hotel on 28th. And in Kaduna, it will be at 17 Hotel in Kaduna.
Thank you.
Oh, we'll have in Abuja after that.
Thank
final
you.
One.
Whilst you were making your presentation, you mentioned that you guys did some kind of research and you have a cluster of communities where the grid doesn't get to, right? Do you have that online where one can access? Is it available online? Thank you.
Thanks everyone for your question. I will start from the first. Yes, for in GVE, we not only, first of all, I want to correct an impression. GVE is 100% for profit. We are not an NGO. So for the RE, residential and SMEs, yes, we also provide solutions. At GVE, we see ourselves as solution providers, provide solutions from rural communities to high end up to the megawatt.
So the question is, how can the rural areas pay?
Yeah, on
the financial.
Yeah, on the issue of affordability and willingness to pay, I would say at the moment we have presence in four different states in the country. By presence, I mean operational sites. And I would say we actually did a lot of market studies. And averagely, an average household in the rural community spent between 300 to 500 naira a day on alternatives. And our systems are usually about one third of that. So it solves the issue of affordability. What we are doing is just expense redirection, redirecting them from unconventional and on clean sources to clean up. To clean our alternatives. And also, basically, we have prepaid meters installed, I would say the smartest in the industry. Ironically, we have them in remote communities, the smartest meters in the industry. And our users, each of our connected clients have prepaid meters. They actually pay only for energy that they use on a kilowatt hour basis. And at the moment, so we've even made it very simple. They can pay using any type of mobile phones, like the very common Nokia Touch that we all know. Then going to the question on the IGI, yeah, coincidentally, I'm an Igbo man. I'm from Anambra State, precisely. Yeah, we Igbos, we have this trend. We try, first of all, to make a little dip, and if we don't get 2 months, we actually jump in fully. So I would say we've taken those very little steps, and at the moment, we are at the point where we want to go for a fly. We have a target as a company to impact 1 million people in the next 6 years, but without regulation. But with the regulation coming in, I would say we'll multiply that in tenfold, because without the regulation, we are skeptical of issues of grid encroachment, issues of having issues with discos and all that, and also having some de-risking factor for our investors. But with the regulation, and interestingly, the government actually did listen to the private sector, and most of the in the regulation were all well spelled out. But I will start my own public consultation now on the issue of exclusivity and the eventual compensation to a distributed electricity service company at the end of the day when there is grid encroachment. There is no well-defined terms for that compensation, and I think it's something the regulator should actually look into, so we don't end up with what we have with Endogo Distribution Company and geometric power. And on the PPA question, yes, we execute agreements, MOUs with the communities, and also we execute a service contract with each and every customer we connect in the rural communities. On real estate, like I did mention, we also work with a couple of real estate developers to deploy solutions for their estates. And at the moment, we are working on a scheme whereby we can deploy affordable, because we've had people in the urban areas ask us a lot of questions. You're powering the villages when in the cities we don't even have light. So very soon we'll be launching a very smart solution for the urban, residential, and commercial solutions. Thank you.
Sanusi, you had a few questions.
Yes. Yeah, the first question was from Dr. Afolabi. He wanted to know what GIZ was doing to have a plan for rural electrification. Well, at the moment, there is no comprehensive master plan for rural electrification in Nigeria in terms of knowing where all the communities are that don't have access to electricity, and how the government plans to connect each of these communities based, given a timeline. That's not available. They have targets of what they intend to meet. So I think the starting point is to have the targets, and that's why we feel this is very important, the issue of having data and plans. So you need to have the data for us before you can have plans. But based on what we can gather, or what we're able to gather in terms of secondary data, available data, we've been able to divide the country into clusters, and that's where I mentioned the issue of cluster analysis. We've done that. At least we know where the areas that currently don't have electricity are. It might be difficult to get exact distance from the nearest grid, because we do not have that data on distribution lines. We have the transmission one. They are just beginning to map distribution networks across the country now. So once that's available, it becomes more comprehensive, and then we can easily calculate distances and know which one should naturally go for the grid. We could have a buffer of 10 kilometers or 20 kilometers depending on what the government agrees on. And after that, you can safely say that if you invest in mini grids 20 kilometers outside the grid, or 10 kilometers outside the grid, you're safe for the next 10 years or whatever. So this involves stakeholders' coordination. We need to bring the discos in to know what their plans are for the next few years. We've identified the clusters. We also need to go down and verify some of these clusters, and attach names to them and all of that. So I think what we have is at best preliminary, but it shows a lot, and it shows us a lot on how far we need to go. So someone asked, Fabian asked about, the cluster analysis. Is it available online? It's not available online yet. But like I said, we is a preliminary study. We have five partner states: Cross River, Ogun, Sokoto, Niger, and Plateau. So what we intend to do is to go into the states and do a detailed plan. And that way, we need to get the names of these communities. We only have the geo coordinates, right now. So we need to, tie each coordinate to a name.
Thank you, Simon, for reminding everyone that the sector has been liberalized, privatized, and if you want, commercialized. And therefore, the IGI is actually what everybody is waiting for. Yes. Now, having said that, there is a question from the gentleman about one mini grid being too small. Dr. Sanusi did allude to the fact that there is no universally accepted definition of a mini grid. Now, regulatory considerations determine exactly what a government or what a regulator or what a policy or law can accept as going to be connected without a license. So in this case, it's strictly to ensure the profitability of those that are buying so that it will be fair and objective. So I think the common definition of a mini grid, we all know, is 10 megawatts. Particularly in the North America, you find that's where the mini grids are. The micro grids are referred to. So I don't think that's an issue that should worry anybody, because there's already other regulation like the captive power generation regulation, which allows for you to do up to 20 megawatts if you want. There's also embedded regulations, which I'm sure regulators are here, they can shed more light to you on that. Now, the same applies to the question on housing projects. It is also highly encouraged because the regulations that were already done by NAC are open for any estate to apply and get a license for a dedicated power or for an embedded power which can go to the distribution company. So I think these regulations are there. It's just for us to look at them and make sure we make best use of them. I think these are the questions I have.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, we'll take another round of questions. Let's start from here. You've had your hands up.
My question is actually for Farouk. Is your department not a duplication of REA? Because I remember you mentioned what you were supposed to do, and it's the same thing that REA does. Then the other thing, it's also for you, Farouk. You said the REA plan will focus on development. What form of development? Are we still going to go back to those days where you put a transformer and extend a line for someone's father's burial and abandon the place after that? Or are we going to be targeting production and manufacturing companies setting up? Why I mention this critically is in order to also answer the question that had been asked earlier. How can the rural people afford to pay? So you need to stimulate that economy by having economically viable institutions, you know, production processes for that. So that's my question.
Thank you very much.
And my question goes to, is it Ifanyi? I want you to share your experience, because the current Nigerian grid is always prone to system instability, leading to voltage collapse or total collapse. From your experience, I would like to know, did you experience any system collapse within the mini grid? And in terms of second question, if there are many residents connected to your mini grid or micro grid, there should be maybe occasions where fault do occur, maybe at very close to where you have your plant or within the customers. How do you address those ones? Thank you.
And I think the main question for me here is all the models I'm aware of, and please I stand corrected if I'm wrong, seem to focus on getting these products in. Right, there is the waiver, the duty waiver for solar panels from the Ministry of Power, which is beautiful because it allows you to pay less, get the items in at a lower rate of duty. Most of the economies I have observed that have taken solar on and made it happen have started with this model of duty exemption, but they have boosted local manufacturing in that area. I've heard a lot of talk about when is IGI happening. I don't know any Igbo guy that puts money into a business where he can't get his money back, right? I would like to start seeing, you know, regulations. You know, I'd like to start seeing programs. I'd like to start seeing finance and loan.
To support local production.
To support local production.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
My question is directed to Ifeanyi. I would like to know, what's the typical cost per kilowatt hour of this, your mini grid, to the rural communities? Thank you.
I keep hearing about regulations. Are these regulations under NEC, Power, REA, or the Ministry of Power? What are they coming under? Are they meant to regulate people who have grids already and encourage people who are bringing them in? And you talked about a committee. I just want to know, where do the legal people come in? Where does the Ministry of Justice come in? You have the Ministry of Environment, you have the Ministry of Power. Do we have to wait to a point where there are disputes between the, as he said, someone said the discos and the mini and micro grid people? Do we have to wait till that before we have a legal framework for?
Thank you. Thank you very much.
To my friend from the Ministry of Power, please put all of those, your policies, and even while in development, okay, on the website, so that we can see, we can know how you're thinking, we can make contributions. It is draft, we know it is draft, you let us know it is draft, and then when we have comments, we can. All have to come to the ministry to be able to get that.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Oladunra Adeswa, from NIAF. I know there's been a lot of questions around the economic viability of those projects, which has actually reached the terminology IGI, which is the first time hearing this evening. Just to speak a little on it, first, the REF comes in as a subsidy buffer for these guys that are going to be benefiting from this project. The fund is not just like a Father Christmas thing. It's supposed to come in, operate like a PPP approach, where the government takes some part of it, which is supposed to run like a subsidy on it. And that is the first, I'll use in explaining the economic viability. The second option is the MTN model. This MTN, I think, is the fast power. I can't really remember the name. But taking a critical look at that solution, it's way more expensive than what the discos are offering right now. And the good news I want to tell you, the IGI, is people are paying. The people that you think they are poor, the people that you think they can't afford it, these people are paying. They are actually, they are recharging, and they are actually paying to run on this thing. Those are the two support option. And on to my main question now for Engineer Farouk. For the REF, there are three options. The first is the microgrid. The first is the mini grid. The second is the microgrid, and the third is the grid extension. I know that a lot has been said about the mini and microgrid, but none has been said about the grid extension. And obviously, one of the sustainable platform for that, unless you just want to keep those guys inside darkness, is the PCAF. I don't know. Is now the rural electrification strategy plan has been activated. Is there any plan from the government to actually look out for the PCAF being activated alongside for the extension guys? Thank you.
Farouk, I think you got most of the questions.
Let me try. Yes. Thank you very much from the Central Africa, right? Setco, sorry. Your question aligns well with the question from Ibrahim. You were asking whether rural electrification is not a duplication, or Renewable Energy and Rural Power Access Department is not a duplication of REE, right? Now, they are entirely two different things. You see, there is the policy space, there is the regulatory space, and then there is the implementation space. We are in the policy space, so we have nothing to do with implementation. REE is in the implementation stage and not to award contracts, but to provide support, financial support and technical support moving forward. Your next question was, what type of development? I've explained, is support through grants, through subsidies and technical assistance. And it's clearly three trunk of grid extension, mini grids, and solar home systems. Either of these they can do. I think your last question is how rural education people can pay. They pay because of the rural education fund. That's the whole essence, to subsidize the capital cost of those projects. So essentially it helped in reducing the cost of the tariffs. Yes. I think Ekenna talked about local manufacturing. There is a number of incentives in place. Most of these incentives you find more with National Investment Promotion Council for manufacturers, as well as Ministry of Trade, Industry, Trade and Investment. We have not been so active, even though the policy have captured the need for encouragement of local manufacturing of this equipment, but it's not the policy's main focus, because there are already existing policies that allow for repatriation of capital, duty, tax incentives, and so on and so forth. So I think that's also considered and is being captured. I think the other question is from NIAB. I've just mentioned that grid extension is one of those 5 years that the Act allows for REA to do. But for obvious reasons, it is not likely that grid extension will take the high priority because of the capacity deficit that is already within the system. So if you continue to extend the grid when the generation capacity is not even enough for the existing system, you have a lot of challenges with distribution companies. So I think the focus for REA will be mostly going to be alternative sources, distributed generation kind of projects. I think AO talked about renewable portfolio standards. Actually, the NREPP policy mentioned about 5 policy options for entry of renewables, not specifically for mini grids, but for renewables as a whole. The first was competitive procurement, which have already commenced. 1,250 megawatts have already been signed by MBET through that process. The second one is feed-in tariffs, which the NAC has already published a feed-in tariff regulation. The next one was renewable portfolio standard. We have not yet any regulation on that, but the policy allows for it to happen. So if the regulator feels they can, they will be able to do that. The other one is net metering. Net metering is also allowed within the policy space, but I'm sure the regulator, net metering is a situation whereby you have two customers selling to the grid and taking power from the grid, and the net is what is being paid at the end of the day. Yes. So I think most of these policies incentives or instruments are actually captured in the policies that government have currently. But because of the level of development of our market, some of them will take time to actually evolve. I think that's what I will say. I can't see any other questions. Thank you.
If I, you had some questions.
Yeah, okay. First of all, I will try to answer the question on system stability and fault management. Like I did mention earlier, the earlier systems we have, what we'll call our first generation system, the system has a 8 to 10 hour availability, and that was basically because we had very limited management and system protection. But then the second generation of systems, we were able to improve on that, and that led to about double initial capacity or initial availability to about 16 hours daily, with what we call the Evolution 3, which is where we are now, and is a model that we are scaling with. We've introduced a lot of system protection, energy management capabilities, and a lot of control. And with that, we currently have 24 hours uninterrupted power supply. And at the moment, we are working out modalities to actually upgrade the initial sites to be what we have now and scale with that. And on the issue of cost per kilowatt hour, I will want to answer the question this way. The average rural client doesn't know what the doesn't know the mathematics involved in the cost per kilowatt hour. What they are all after is the bottom line, how much leaves my pocket at the end of the day. And based on that, our systems are a lot more affordable than what they used to spend on alternatives. But to answer the question correctly, our tariff is about 127 naira per kilowatt hour. It seems outrageous, but I would say our clients are about the most energy efficient people we have in the country. So they use energy efficient appliances, and with that they're able to manage their consumption so that at the end of the day, the actual cost or the actual consumption on a daily basis is low, and the actual cost to them on a daily basis is a lot cheaper than what they spend on alternatives. And that was our tariff is that high because we as a private sector, we took in a lot of risk when we invest in the generation, the distribution, and also the metering infrastructure. And also there were uncertainties about grid encroachment issues, so we modeled our system to have a short ROI and payback. So, but with the introduction, that was why I kept emphasizing on the crucial importance of the regulation. And with the introduction of the regulation, a lot of things are going to change, and with the SIP as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I think Sanusi?
Yes, please. Oladira mentioned something about the grid extension and why that option is not being discussed. I mean, clearly the theme for today is mini grids, but just to answer that, we already have a lot of grid extension to the rural areas that are not powered right now, because obviously with the reforms going on and the privatization of the distribution companies, most of them are just after where they can get, you know, get their money from, who's going to pay for it. And if you know very well that the R1 is applicable in rural areas, and that means they will have to pay less if you're on the grid. You also mentioned the issue of the PCAF, the Power Consumer Assistance Fund. Maybe Farouk would want to comment on that. He asked why the guideline has not, you know, is not yet out or has not been designed yet, the Power Consumer Assistance Fund. But I don't think anybody wants, you know, to continue extending grid 10, 20 kilometers into rural areas where for upwards of 10, 15 years, the discos never supply electricity to. I mean, even in cities right now, where they know they are known for not paying, you know, bills, discos, you know, shy away from supplying electricity to them. My village now, I'm from Kogi State, Okene, you know, they only get 2 hours of electricity and they are complaining. And the excuse is that, well, most of you guys do not pay for electricity. So we are trying to see how we can sensitize them, you know, to pay for electricity. Talk more of rural areas where they even get less money from, 4 naira per kilowatt, I think. And the PCF is still not operationalized yet to cover up for that subsidy. So maybe Farouk would want to tell us when we are going to get that guideline.
Well, I'm not sure I get the question very well, but if my assumption is right, you are referring to when are we going to have consumer assistance fund operationalized, right? I think that has a lot to do with the market. These are issues to do with the ability to put more burden on somebody that is already overburdened. So to that extent, I think we will see consumer assistance fund fully functional when maybe the market becomes a bit more liquid, away from where we are today. As you are aware, the market isn't paying so far. So I think that's what I can say for that. However, Dr. Duko is here and Yusuf is here. They are in a better position to talk on this issue.
The PCAF is actually, when the act started, they created two institutions and two funds, NERC and REA, the institutions, and PCAF, that's Power Consumer Assistance Fund, and REF are the funds created by the act. The two institutions, NERC and REA, are there, but the two funds are yet to be properly in place because, like what you have said, where is the fund to mop up to subsidize what already doesn't exist? It requires that the PCF to be active. You should have what you call eligible customers who are going to pay much into this fund. Then there will be budgetary allocation from government. There will be donor agencies funding to the PCF. But up till now, eligibility has not been declared, so you don't have eligible customers who can pay this fund. You also should have cross subsidy where some people will pay more than what they ought to have paid, so that will go into the PCF to help those indigent customers. But now, you know, the discos are telling you that they are not getting enough in from those who actually consume now, who are R2 customers and R3 customers, are not paying their bills. So there is not enough now to scoop and keep into PCF to help. So we hope that by the time, like I said, when the market grows bigger and then become more liquid, and then when the eligible customers are declared by the minister, and then we now have those ones paying into the Power Consumer Assistance Fund, it will be available to help the indigent customers. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We've come to the end of this session. Thank you so much.